the one. He is Jesus.
He is our King. He is our love. He is our God.
Good morning. Welcome to worship on this lovely day that we have in front of us. We're grateful to have you with us. Special welcome to those who are at home, and thank you for Sharon Messelt for sponsoring today's broadcast. For anyone watching on live stream or on Facebook Live, Sharon sponsored the broadcast in gratitude for everyone who's reached out in the last month since her husband Noel died. And so thank you. as a congregation as we've walked alongside them and keeping her family in your prayers. We have had a very crazy week here with VBS, so Vacation Bible School was this past week. A lot of fun, great to see the kids. You'll see a few videos of the kids from this past week in worship today, just to kind of see what they were up to. And then tomorrow we start, we're sending 30 people up to the Boundary Waters, so we've got four groups that are pretty full, and we're excited for that. Looking forward to sharing those stories with you next week as we spend Monday to Friday up in the Boundary Waters. We also want to point to the upcoming art show this next September. So each week we're giving you some prompts to give you some ideas on, like, hey, maybe this will stir up something in terms of artistic ideas. Whatever ideas you have are great and welcomed. And so you got Psalm 143 and John 14 to look to, as well as if you'd like to grab one of the hymnals and read through the verses of ELW hymn 395. So those are your options there. And then last week I also mentioned how we were walking alongside a family that was a big family here in Forest Lake that was in need. They were unsettled and looking for housing. This family's been able to get housed this past week, and our congregation responded with so much abundance and so much love, and they've been very appreciative. The bottom is a text from the mom who was very thankful for all that we've been able to do to help her family, and just a thank you to all of us here at Faith. So thanks for everybody who stepped up and brought in items throughout the week or were able to provide some donations. If you'd like to continue to help, we'll have more information in the Tuesday email this week as they're getting settled and back on their feet in their new home. So thank you. And speaking of homes and housing and all of that, one of the things our congregation has been doing a lot in the last few years is talking about how we can help with tiny houses. This is the very first sacred settlement that is going in at Mosaic Christian Community in St. Paul. Our church sponsored one of the homes. Technically, it's right behind the first house in blue. It's this one. This was sponsored by Faith for David, who's a veteran, and so we specifically wanted that to be the house that we were able to walk alongside David and be able to have for him. They're getting all of these houses are getting settled in there, and hopefully they'll be able to move in the next couple of weeks. And so we'll give you some more updates as that's all coming together. One of our members, Steve Schultz, is shared these pictures with us. He went down to Mosaic this week and was able to help out with some of the projects that they had. And so grateful for all of the ways our congregation continues to step in to this important ministry as we move forward as a congregation. Moving from these tiny houses to literally one of the coolest tiny houses I've ever seen. I do invite you to stand. John Fisher died this week. He's been sick with cancer, and one of the things he did when he knew, you know, with his diagnosis, one of the things he wanted to do was to build his own urn. And it's this beautiful cabin. He built his own cabin as an urn to be able to put his ashes in. And it's just gorgeous. So this is him with a picture of him with his urn in front of him. So keep Karen in your prayers this week. His funeral is going to be next Sunday after worship. We're going to have a visitation after this service, and then the service will start at 2 o'clock next Sunday afternoon. So thinking of Karen, and certainly grateful for the gift of John and for all of the people in his life who are praying and thinking about him this week. So let's pray for him. Heavenly God, we thank you for John and for his ability to share that promise of resurrection with you as we speak, and to know that he is in this new heavenly dwelling, and we appreciate the gift of all of the things he did here on earth. His skills as a woodworker and the gifts that he's been able to provide to share love with so many on this earth. He is now with you in heaven. And so please be with Karen and all of his kids and family as they are mourning this week. In your holy name we pray. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And also with you. I invite you to take a moment to share the peace with those who are around you as we begin our worship today. As Amy pointed out, everyone is sitting on the groom's side today.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord.
It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only, God. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. 'Cause it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only, God.
We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever. We take this time now as we pause for reflection and confession of our sins. And let us now confess together our sins in the presence of God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we've not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. So now hear the good news, that God doesn't deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. And so in the name of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. We are free to love as God loves us. Amen. And so let us pray together the prayer of the day. Eternal God, you draw near to us in Christ, and you make yourself our guest. amid the cares of our lives, make us attentive to your presence, that we may treasure your word above all else. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. We have a very special guest today for our prayer lab. And so Deacon Nina went on the road again, but she didn't go very far. And this is back when she still was pregnant. So yes, no optical illusions here. This was filmed a while ago. She actually took about 10 steps to go on the road for this one. So you'll probably recognize who she is on the road with today.
Well, hello everyone, Deacon Nina here with our next installment of Prayer Lab Minute on the Road, and I'm here today with Kyle Trepp. Thanks for being with me, Kyle. Yeah. I was wondering if you could share with everyone about a practice of prayer that's been meaningful for you.
Yeah, my prayer practice at home involves picking up my guitar and not necessarily playing anything written by anybody, just playing chords and relaxing and connecting with God in that way.
Beautiful. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious, like, when did you start practicing this, and how has it changed your faith or your relationship with God since you sort of figured it out?
Sure. It's been a long process to figure it out. I mean, when I started playing music, I was 6 years old, so I wasn't that great, but
still doing it.
Yeah. But when I had a busy or a long day at school when I was young, I would come home and just play guitar to relax. It's kind of grown into more of a connecting with God now that I'm older and my faith is stronger, to relax and get that that feeling of peace with God while I play.
Yeah, it's like meditation.
Meditation, yes.
That's beautiful. Cool. So what advice or encouragement would you give to someone who maybe wants to try using music in their prayer or adapting music how they already use it for their prayer life?
Right. You know, not everyone plays a musical instrument, and that's okay. I've listen to piano on the searching on YouTube to listen to piano and just meditate that way, or your favorite worship song on KTIS or anything like that, to put you in that mind space to connect with the Lord.
Yeah. Beautiful. Even like a playlist.
Even
easy.
Any
easy
song that together. Anything, yes.
Or CD, record if you're old school.
Right, like yes.
That.
Yes.
Right, like that. Yeah. Awesome. Well, thanks so much, Kyle, for sharing with me. This has been wonderful. And I may be coming to your music studio next.
Sounds good.
Thanks, Kyle. That was awesome, man. Let's give you some props. Yeah, very, very appreciative of that. I'm gonna invite the kids to come on up right now. You get to watch a video here. So we're all gonna talk a little bit. This was Vacation Bible School week, and so, you know, just have you come on up and get to immerse ourselves in what happened during Vacation Bible School. Now, one of the things that you're going to witness is there was a water day, and so all of the kids got pretty wet, and there maybe were some different, some of the kids had different levels of how wet they got based off of how well they played one of these particular games. So here's how that game played out. Oh, there's Agent Bees right there. I recognize him. All right. I believe you played this game, correct? How wet did you get when you played? Did you get pretty wet or not very wet? Okay. Was there like a strategy to... Like, did most people want to try to get people really, really wet, or was there... Oh, she got her pretty good on that one. Okay. Oh, I mean, that's just dripping right there, right? He's like... He's not messing around. Carson knows exactly. How was that not a drop, right? I, like, he just, like, let that thing out. It's got to be coming soon. Oh, there it is. Excellent. More water games here. Sponge tag. Basically, the point of this game is to just get people wet. Looks like a pretty hot day. Now, I think that's one of the camp counselors, right? We had camp counselors here. We had four different counselors from Camp Onania, and they had a great time. What was the name of your camp counselor? Sydney? Oh, you just dunked your brother on that one. I didn't miss that. Nicely done. It looked like you had a great time, and we're gonna hear. So it was clearly you had some fun activities throughout the week, but you also you learned some good songs about Jesus and all that. So we're gonna hear those after the sermon today. So really excited to see just how much fun you guys are having. You had a good time. Do it again, okay? You guys excited for Sunday school's coming and all that fun stuff. So let's pray together. Heavenly God. Thank you for Vacation Bible School.
Thank you for Vacation Bible School.
For the camp counselors.
For the camp counselors.
The volunteers. And all the friends that came together. To learn about you. And have fun. Sing songs. And praise God. Amen. All right, thanks very much for coming on up.
A reading from Amos. The time is surely coming, says the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the word of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. A gospel reading from the 10th chapter of Luke. Now as Jesus and his disciples went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift.
Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as you choose. Here am I,
here am I,
all of me,
all of me.
I don't know about you, but when she was reading, anybody else want to go, Martha, Martha, Martha? Anyway, grace and peace to you, my friends in faith. I had a lot of time in the car this week, and so the twins didn't play every time I was driving, so I had to think of other things to listen to. So I was listening to some of Luther Seminary's got this Sermon Brainwave podcast that I listen to, where they get three professors from the seminary together and they talk about the upcoming scripture for the week. A great resource that I've appreciated over the years, where they've got a nice theological perspective on the text, but then also kind of weave in like how this might relate to us in our current setting today, and thinking about how the gospel that we just heard Evie read, how does this affect us? So I had a lot of time, and so I listened to the podcast that they just recorded, you know, in the last week or two to get ready for this Sunday. But I also decided, let's listen to what they said 3 years ago. And then I finished that podcast, and I'm like, well, let's hear what they said 3 years before that. And it was interesting because they actually repeated themselves quite a bit, where they kind of initially said the same thing, but then each conversation kind of veered in a different direction. They found a different thread within this passage that they latched onto. But the beginning of each of these conversations started with Professor Matt Skinner from the seminary saying, wow, this is a really hard text. And then Professor Caroline Lewis would agree with him. It was basically, that's how the exchange went all three times. And I know what you're thinking. This might be a surprise. You're like, if you've heard this passage about Mary and Martha before, you're probably thinking, man, this is pretty familiar and straightforward. And you might even think, wow, you know, are you a Martha? Or are you a Mary? And what is implied with that, right? So if you're a Martha, right, you're the one who likes to work. Your hospitality is so important to you. She's missing the cues that she should just stop working and sit down and be in the presence of Jesus. And for some reason, despite her obedience, despite she's doing all of the things that she's supposed to do, she actually gets reprimanded for it. And it's one of those weird moments where you're like, man, really? Like, we want to criticize people for doing something really good. But then you got Mary on the other side, and it's kind of like awkward, like, okay, she's not doing the thing, she's not helping her sister, she's just sitting there with Jesus. And she's foregone that, you know, this is her obligation, but she's decided it's more important to sit with Jesus. And then Jesus actually compliments her for it. And it's kind of confusing, isn't it? Like, what's going on here? And so Matt Skinner, said that sometimes we oversimplify this text, and that it's not helpful to do that because there's three reasons why this passage is actually tough for us to discern. And the first point that he makes is, it's not exactly clear what Jesus is talking about in verse 42. I think we sometimes hear verse 42 when he's complimenting Mary, and he says, Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her. And we're like, what do you mean? Like, what's that all about? Like, what happens to Martha? Which is his second point. The interpretive history of this text is hard, he said, because oftentimes there's a winner and a loser. We've kind of made this a zero-sum game. For Mary to win, Martha has to lose, which he also says, this is kind of awkward. And then third, It's because this passage has been treated as, this is what it's like to be in discipleship as a woman. Because there are so few passages in the gospel that have female characters, and in a passage like this where one of them speaks, it's like we put all of our eggs in the basket to say, this is what it means to be a female disciple. It's not like if, you know, Peter and James had a fight, we'd be like, and that's how you have male discipleship. We don't do that. This is an awkward thing for us to lift up. Like this one very brief exchange is like, well, either you're a Martha or you're a Mary. And something about having this hardworking Martha getting this unfair label and this criticism, it's weird that we're criticizing her for her hard work ethic. And at the same time, are we putting too much of a lazy characteristic on Mary? It doesn't seem like that's a very fair way to do it either. So Professor Lewis had some wisdom that she chimed in too. She's like, look, this is not an either or. It's not fair to just say this is one way and this is the other way and there's no other compromise. And she made a point to say, sometimes we need to be a both and. Like there's some very important times where hospitality matters and how we treat others and how we serve this world and being able to be a servant for God, very, very important. But sometimes God wants us to just stop and listen. I think about why we do prayer lab every week, right? This is an important part of our spiritual discipline. It's like, why are we learning about God? Well, we want to learn some spiritual practices through the week. Yes, we want to serve, but yes, we want to be able to listen. And so it doesn't really do either Mary or Martha justice if we've said there's really only two ways to do this. So maybe the takeaway from a passage, a very hard passage, as Skinner said, maybe the takeaway from this passage about being a Mary or a Martha isn't necessarily like you're one or the other, but what about we think about the sibling dynamics? What if we think about some of the complicated relationship dynamics that are at play? Hey, I want you to think about some of your own interesting relationships. Maybe you've got some siblings where you're not always on the same page. Maybe you've got a stressful relationship with a coworker. Maybe within your own family, it's a mother or a mother-in-law. You know, there's certain scenarios where you're like, you're immediately going to have a different pivot or a reaction to somebody based off of like your history with that person. Mary and Martha are definitely an example of the history that they've had, and this isn't necessarily a unique situation where Martha's doing the work and Mary is the one who's not. And Martha does something fascinating in this exchange. She sees what's going on, and here's the deal, right? Like, Jesus is talking, and Martha's like, I have all this stuff to do. I got to get all my work done, right? I got to get everything ready. And everything that I do is a reflection upon me, including the behavior of the other people in my household. So like, my sister Mary, that lazy slob, she's a bad reflection on me. So here's Martha, she's tidying everything up, she's making sure everything's neat and orderly, and she's like, okay, got everything. And here's Mary. She's like, oh, Jesus, just keep talking. This is so wonderful. I just love everything that you have to say. She's kind of like some of you right now, right? Actually, you guys are doing great. 9 o'clock, we had a few nodders. Anyway, they were out, and that woke them up. And so you got Mary who's just like, oh, Jesus, continue to tell me about this. What does Martha do? Martha, in this really weird family dynamic, she's like, okay, I'm busting my butt over here. And Mary is just laying down on the floor listening to Jesus. So does Martha like stand over here and look at Mary and say, hey, Mary, get back to work. What does she do? What does she do? Hey, Jesus, tell my sister to get back to work. She triangulates Jesus. Like, really? It's like you're trying to figure out your family weird dynamics by making Jesus reprimand your sister? What? That's a horrible idea. Do you think Jesus is going to be like, you know what, Martha? That's a really good idea. Your lazy sister over there should be working. That is not how this works. Jesus, you want to talk about deflecting and healthy boundaries and saying something that really startles us when he's not even like saying, yeah, Martha, he could compliment her, like the house looks beautiful, just have a seat. He's like, no, Mary's actually doing the better part. Like, I'm here in your presence and I just want you to be in my presence. She's got the better part. Triangles. If you've ever been in a triangle, We've all been in a triangle. We've all been all over a triangle, right? Like an emotional triangle is any three members of a relationship system or any two members plus an issue or a symptom, right? So it very well could be two people having a conflict where one person's going to pull someone in and say, this thing over here, this is something we should be really worried about. And this person hadn't even thought about it. There's no stress or anxiety at all. And all of a sudden they're like, oh my goodness, I should be really nervous about that. We've all been part of this. And I've given you some examples. I mean, maybe this is family dynamics. Maybe this is stuff happening out in the world. Maybe this is you and a coworker where you've got, I mean, let's be honest. We all have that coworker, right? Like, I don't, but like you do, right? So like we all have that person in our life where they're gonna definitely try to rope you in and have some gossip. And sometimes that gossip is so juicy, isn't it? Like you're just like, I really wanna hear this. Tell me more. And you have to give like a little bit of buy-in, like that you're acknowledging that whatever they're telling you is actually pretty accurate. And you're like, well, tell me more. Like, and so the more that you kind of give, the more they'll give back. That's exactly what's going on in these triangles, right? Sometimes we've been the one who's spreading that gossip, and sometimes we're the one who's over here completely oblivious, and we're the ones getting hurt by two people who formed a triangle against us. This text is kind of in a weird way showing us how dangerous that can be, isn't it? Jesus doesn't fall for this trap, thank God. Jesus is like, the problem isn't Mary. The problem, Martha, is your own anxiety. Martha, you're afraid as a disciple that you're not going to measure up. Martha, you're afraid you've become too anxious, you've become too worried that you're not doing enough. And you know what, Martha? You are enough. And Mary is a great example of what it means to just be present. She's chosen the better part. And Jesus points this out and tells Mary not to worry. It tells Martha, don't worry, don't be anxious. I've seen this play out. I saw this play out in a conversation between two women this past week where they were having this conversation, and I wasn't part of the conversation other than just like being in the room, but the two of them, like it was starting to get kind of like heated, and the one woman was just noticeably, her tone got really different. Like she got really mad after her friend started asking her some questions about her job. And so she just started getting so worked up. She's like, ugh, I'm so mad. And she started just venting and letting it all out. And she started talking about, you know, I think I'm just going to quit. But the other friend didn't just completely fully buy in. She just started to ask some questions and listened. And then when the friend was starting to try to suck her into this triangle, she goes, oh, I'm really sorry that you felt that way. And then she started saying, oh, you know, when she realized that this wasn't quite working, she starts naming names. She's like, and this guy, he's entitled. He's not helping me get what I want. He's not helping me get this job that I deserve. And instead of saying, oh, yeah, that jerk, she kind of just stopped. And she goes, you know, I know the person that you're talking about, and that just hasn't been my experience in working with him. And she completely deflected it, and she was like, look, she acknowledged that she heard, but she also didn't completely just give away the farm. Like, she just kind of sat with this and let her have those emotions, wasn't trying to change them. Like, she wasn't telling her, like, no, you're overreacting. But she just really let this conversation happen. She listened. She supported her friend. She didn't get herself stuck in the triangle. It was refreshing to see how healthy her responses were. And when she did this, it didn't offend this friend. She wasn't like, well, why can't you take my side more? It didn't create additional conflict. Instead, she was able to own her truth. She was able to own her own self-awareness in this experience, in this relationship. And just because this other woman had some negative opinions, it's not as if she was going to allow that to change her own opinion and her own experiences. In many ways, you could say that she was choosing the better part. She wasn't choosing to match the anxiety of her friend. I think we can all agree that being a disciple sometimes can be really, really hard. And it can be even harder when we think it's on us to do everything. It can be even harder when we want to compare ourselves to other churches or ourselves to other Christians and be like, man, I'm not doing it as well as this guy over here or her. And we might start feeling like we need to rank ourselves and we're just not quite doing it good enough. And when you feel like you're getting pulled into a triangle, remember that it's usually not about you. Remember some of those tools. It's okay to deflect. It's really, really, really important to establish healthy boundaries. It's really important to resist contributing to gossip that you know is just gossip. It's not real. Remember the eighth commandment. It's important to resist adding anxiety and throwing that fuel on the fire. Because there's a lot to be anxious about. We have worries, we have fears. Some are very legitimate, and some in our heads we have overblown more than they ever could be. When we talked about this at Old Guys this week, one of the guys said, tell me the things I'm not worried about, and that list will be much shorter. We might wonder to ourselves, well, what's in store? What's coming up next? We don't know. And God doesn't want us to live that way. Don't let worry consume us. Don't create drama where it's not needed. That is choosing the better part. So choose the better part and live. Live the abundant life that God has given us through God's abundant grace. Amen. As we continue with our worship, we remember how we give our gifts and our offerings to the Lord. Thank you for all of the ways that you've been able to support our ministries this past week, especially being able to lend a hand to this family that we've been walking alongside. Great to see all the fruits and vegetables come in on Wednesday as we bring those to the food shelf. Also love seeing those tiny houses and that ministry that we really helped kind of start that momentum to be coming to fruition. So thank you, Faith. It's such a gift to be part of this congregation. But one of the things I love about this congregation is how much we care about our children, how much we support their growth, and how much we want to walk alongside them. And so you got to see how they played all their water games. But our special music today, it's from some of our younger voices who are going to share some really, really just touching camp songs. Some of these might be familiar to you if you've been to camp in your life. So here's the kids. They get to take it away.
Thank you.
Well, that was fun. I'm just tired watching that. I'll invite you to stand as we share in this prayer of offering. And let us pray. O God of abundance, you've set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus, amen. This time we'll share in the prayers together as a church, and so I'll come around if you have some prayers that you would like to lift up. Just say them out loud and I'll repeat them as we gather our hearts together. Heavenly God, in this time we know that you go with us, and so we thank you for this congregation. We thank you for the ways that we are stirred up to hear your call, to be able to put aside fears and anxieties and worries, and to just be present with you and to go out into this world knowing that you've called us to serve. And so as we think of our loved ones or we think of those who are in need of healing, we lift them up to you in this time. For Lauren, for Bonnie. For Diane Novak, for Mike's family. We thank you, God, for all of the Vacation Bible School students this past week, and ask that you bless the students who are going on the canoe trip this week and the chaperones. Bless them with good weather and good bug spray. And we lift up all of these prayers in this time as we come before you today. In your holy name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And so it was that on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Together we join in the words as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. For those of you who are at home, the body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you, you're welcome to share in this time of communion with those who are around you. And now may the body and blood which you've now received, strengthen and keep you in God's grace. Amen. I invite you to get the hand in the air and let's turn and face someone. You're going to give the blessing, but also to receive this blessing. What a great gift this is to know that as we go into this world, God's blessed us. So I invite you to share these words and speak them out loud. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord's face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May the Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. Amen.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful. Where streams of abundance flow, blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name.
every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Cause you give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
As we gather together at the table, we know that this gift is given to us as a freely given gift from God. We know that God is going with us as we go out into this world. All are welcome to this table set before us today. So go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Have a great week, everybody. I'll invite you to come forward now, and we'll have some communion. As you're leaving today, you can place your cups over there in the basket right over there.